So I'll be talking about taking RISC-V beyond the general purpose solutions today. And this is, I represent Encore today. I gave my first RISC-V conference in 2014 where I've introduced Shakti to RISC-V, and today I introduce Encore to RISC-V. So Encore Semiconductors, this is founded by the members of the Shakti team, the research team to create commercial RISC-V solutions that can leverage the research that has happened over Shakti, the effort and the engineering effort that has gone behind Shakti. Encore is basically the commercial entity that backs Shakti and goes beyond Shakti. We want to produce usable industrial grade solutions and move out of the academic zone so we get more adoption for Shakti. And Encore's primary focus today is going to be on AI ML, security and IoT, and fault tolerant applications. So before going into what we have to present, I'd like to give you a motivation of why we chose those. So the challenge till recently in processor designs or implementations have been purely on the performance and area improvements, right? So you've typically got those by shrinking nodes. You've come down to 14 nanometers, 7 nanometers. You get small area, and you get a higher frequency by default, right? But the free lunch is over. Out-of-order architectures have hit a, you know, that's only so much that you can do today. And the performance improvements only come from domain-specific applications, right? You got to create hardware for specific domains, whether it's AI, ML, security, secure boot. You got to put in specific digital circuit to do that. And general-purpose solutions are not going to work out anymore. So performance improvements can now come only using specific domain domain-specific architectures. AI, ML are probably the domains that matter the most. We'll see the next slide as to why that is. Security was always an afterthought. The money was always on getting highest performance, 3 gigahertz, 3.5, 4 gigahertz, 5 gigahertz, right? Security was never a concern. It was okay if people hacked it, if people broke it. But today, with IoT going everywhere and banking solutions, financial technologies, looking at critical automotive solutions, avionics, security can no longer be an afterthought. And computing has to be reliable. You cannot put any random chip in a life-critical situation, in nuclear power plants, avionics, automotives. The chips need to be really reliable. They have a lot of tolerance to faults if they're going into space applications. And they should have a diagnosis system as well. So the future is in processor enhanced for either AI, ML, or security or reliability. So just a quick relevance of why each of these. The computing is increasingly moving to edge. You're going to have a lot of edge devices, smart cities, info cities, AI cities coming up all over the planet. And each of these are going to have small sensors, small nodes, your small cameras, speaking devices. All of them are going to keep running neural networks, right? And to support those, you need something that's capable of accelerating without a huge overhead. You can't put in a GPU with a small sensor to get to do facial recognition, right? Or you need to have special architectures for those. So intelligence has become a major concern. Security, you're going to put them in payment gateways, real-time monitoring. You want to put private data, health monitoring. Each of those entities need to make sure that your data remains with you, right? No third-party application or no third-party user has access to those data. So at the node itself, you got to make sure that, you know, you communicate minimal amounts of data back to the server. So you have less amounts of points of leakage. So security is a major concern. Automotive, you're going to put in a lot of chips. This is just one example. Like Tesla coming in, Ford going full-fledged into automotives and electronics. This is just going to increase. You're going to have more than, you know, a couple of hundreds of electronic chips out there. And each of these need to be reliable. Each of these need to go through some standard checks. And therefore, reliability has become a major concern today. So we are rethinking processor design. We don't want to go by the basic five-stage pipeline. I'm going to do DMIPS and I'm going to get the best processor out there. No, right? What we say is when we build processors, intelligence, security, and reliability will be the first primary citizens that we design with, right? Everything that we design are going to, every architecture optimizations that we put in will go through these steps of meeting one of these goals out there. And these new features need to be present inherently in all devices, redefining the very notion of general purpose. So we don't say general purpose is just DMIPS or just core marks. General purpose is for IO, for AI ML, general purpose for security. So these have to be inbuilt native hardware elements that are present with any processor that comes out. So the Encore strategy, to put it quite small, be the leadership across the RISC-V core spectrum, from ultra low power IoT to desktop. and leverage these cores to bring AI, ML security and reliability to the center stage. And yes, we're not being redundant. We do have a plan for that. So what we're going to do here is we use enhanced RISC-V general purpose cores that are already out there. And we're going to enhance them and optimize them for three different verticals, the intelligence-enabled cores, the security and the reliability. And we are only targeting the edge. Edge is where the action is. Edge is where the mass volume is. That's where even RISC-V has been known to beat a lot of its existing customers. And Encoder plans to leverage that particular domain and encroach into that market. So what are the base cores that we're going to use? These are the basic Shakti cores, the foundation core one. This is a three-stage core. This has already been done. It has been ported on FPGAs, running free RTOS. That's already available. All of the development is in BlueSpec. So the typically targeted for the sub-200 megahertz range or FPGA soft cores. That's where we will be using E-class for. And the second foundation core is going to be the C-class. This is the one that's going to enter majority of the market. So this can clock up to 500 to 1 megahertz, 1 gigahertz on the ASIC chips that you can, for a particular PDK, obviously. So this is a basic 5 to 6 stage 64-bit slash 32-bit microcontroller. Supports the entire Linux, the Linux kernel that's out there for RISC-V. We have done a couple of RTOS boots on that. The JTAG, OpenOCD, a lot of what is available with RISC-V has been done and supported by C-class today. That's basically the test bed for a lot of other optimizations, a lot of other new developments that we do. And this forms the basis for a lot of other, for a lot of future AIML cores that we're going to have. So the first series, that's the Axon series is what we call it. And the Axon is basically the intelligence-enabled cores. So I'm going to give a brief view of what we're targeting and what we are working with in each of the three categories. I'll start off with the intelligence-enabled Axon series. So three targets. We're going to accelerate sparse models. So if you're looking at edge devices, they're going to be really small, resource constrained. So we're going to have architectures that have been hacked at the architectural, at the micro-architecture level, at the micro-stage level, right, pipeline stages, which can support accelerating sparse models. Have custom hardware accelerators, which are lightweight. And we're also going to give a real-time guarantee for some of these architectures. So sparsity aware, low-end edge devices are resource-constrained. They're resource-constrained in the compute. They're resource-constrained in memory. You're not allowed to have a lot of RAM over there. You're not allowed to clock higher because of the energy constraints that are out there. And workloads in these scenarios are typically going to be sparse. You've got to fit and, you're going to RAM that small neural network into that memory and then have your code base and have database and have sensors working, everything into a small chip, right? So Encoder sparsity aware core leverages this behavior. We provide customized hardware to accelerate sparse computations. So we look into the next slide. We have special data structures which leverages some of the research done at Purdue University by Professor Anand. And this basically adds certain data structures as hardware blocks into your architecture, and there'll be certain instruction sets, minimal instruction sets that we use to maintain the data structure, which allows you to skip a lot of sparse computations which are redundant. And we're also looking at optimizing cache hierarchy to leverage sparsity further. So this is the microarchitecture, a top-level diagram of what we plan to do with the E-class. The idea is to have small blocks of... So these are your sparse-aware blocks that we're going to add in, right? And what it really does is, in a sparse computation, you're going to have a lot of zeros in a matrix. And there's a loop that does matrix multiplication in software, right? And these hardware structures will help you identify which loops you can actually skip. And the skip is not just execution. The skip is actually avoid fetching it. So I reduce memory traffic altogether. I don't fetch the instruction itself. And this particular, the first draft that we have is known to give us, or the experiments that we've run is known to give us around 20 to 25% increase in throughput or energy, right? So we skip a lot of computations. We skip fetching a lot of instructions. And simultaneously, what we are also doing is we are attacking the cache hierarchy. What you're trying to do is store the network or the sparse network in an optimal way. We have augmented caches which can enable that. Specialized data structures, which will make sure that my cache density remains really good, really high. I don't store the redundant computations or the redundant zeros in a lot of spaces, and I have a separate data structure that maintains them. So that gives me a further boost in hierarchy of memory fetches that I do from the cache, right? The next series in the axon, the next element in the axon series is this lightweight systolic arrays, right? So mid-range IoT devices regularly employ workloads, have regular workloads, so you can actually employ a regular systolic array to do matrix multiplications. Applications in these scenarios also need a hard time bound on the execution platform. So Encode integrates its cores with a lightweight customized systolic array. So these are going to be, the first draft is going to be available with the standard Shakti offerings. The customized versions is where Encode will strategize on leveraging the time computes, the time bounds. What we realize today is a lot of AI and ML is going into automotives, avionics, right? But none of these AI ML have a framework where you can guarantee the time bounds, right? We have SEL4, we have ways to standardize on real-time guarantees for general purpose processors, but to do that for a custom hardware accelerator which interacts with sensors or with the host PC, a standard platform is not available. And we are sort of trying to achieve that through some of our worst case execution time analysis. I've not covered that as part of this talk, but I could talk more offline. So for the AI ML, we are using the open source TVM software stack. We've started hacking it, trying to create the LLVM supports for the RISC-V and customized supports for the systolic arrays as well. So this is the general purpose architecture for systolic. We have a systolic array that's parameterized. We have global buffers. We are borrowing concepts from existing architectures, TPUs and other a lot of different architectures. We are coming up with our own set of implementations and optimizations that can suit the IoT domain as well. We have banking, we have accumulator buffers, and this sits currently as a peripheral, right? This is not a standalone chip. This is going to be very tightly coupled to the core itself. And hard real-time guarantees. Time guarantees are a growing concern for AI ML solutions being deployed in life-critical systems. A RISC-V core. So what we envision is in-core selling out is a basic RISC-V core, which has a real-time guarantee through the standard ISO techniques that are out there, frameworks that are out there. An AI accelerator, which gives you a time guarantee. So if you're deploying a neural network like AlexNet or a VGGNet, we give you a software platform which tells you that this is the time guarantee for this particular architecture, right? That this model for image recognition on Shakti Axon series with this historic array is gonna give you this much of a guarantee, right? So we have that, we plan to deploy that platform as well. And a software framework to evaluate and customize SoC for variable real-time requirements. The next vertical that we are targeting is the Aegis series. That's the security-enabled cores. We are looking at optimizing our microarchitecture or basically strengthening our microarchitecture for, again, side-channel attacks. We've started with power side-channel attacks today. Standard secure designs, TPMs, trusted platforms. We are also part of the secure, the TEE group that has been recently formed. We are also trying to define and use some of those as part of the Shakti effort. And tagged architectures, this was something that we've started off a couple of years back and still moving it forward. So side channel mitigation, so this is one of the works that's happening at IIT Madras with Professor Chester and Arshad, his MS student. The idea is to identify and profile the core for a particular series of benchmarks, like crypto algorithms, and see what are the most leakage points or critical points in the hardware or the layout which can leak a lot of data. Right. So the methodology is to identify heat signatures of various modules, identify Hamming distance as a metric. So this is something that we're working on the research. We plan to publish it in a couple of months. And we're also identifying blocks or modules or hierarchy of modules within the architecture, which can help us identify and actually propose architectures or changes at the RTL level, which can avoid those mitigations, avoid those side channel attacks. And this is purely from the power side channel. Standard secure designs. So we are developing standard secure cores, which will sit tightly coupled to the processors. We have AES, SHA, RSA, ISA extensions. We are also exploring on proposing ISA extensions for the security group, where we can put in small extensions in a low-cost profile processor like the E-class, which can accelerate certain crypto algorithms. And these can be offloaded as your trusted platform cores, right? Because that's where they have a lot of benefits for them. Secure boot, memory protection, tamper detect protection. Some of these works have already been done at IIT Madras, at RISE Lab for different projects. We have done indigenous tablets, and some of these have already been proven in software and hardware. We tend to leverage those for INCO's strategy, INCO's AG series. And tagged architectures. So if you've been part of last year's HASP at 2017, we presented a paper on Shakti T, which basically says about tagging every data element with one-bit tag, which enables you to define it either as a pointer or a data element. And that will help you prevent buffer overflow attacks. And given that, since 1 year, we've also optimized that. We have a fat pointer solution, and we actually have a LLVM structure, NLVM infrastructure out there. We've run a couple of code benchmarks, spec benchmarks. We're looking at code densities and what's the overheads and optimizing those. And all of this has been done on the C class. And the overheads that we had for some of these implementations were less than 10 to 15% in hardware overheads, right, maintaining. Software overheads, we're still profiling them. We are expecting them to be within the 15% overhead mark so that it's still usable and deployable in the market. Micro VMs, this is a research domain that we're looking at where we do function calls. We do tagging at a function level, so there's less amount of LLVM and, you know, compiler injection or hacks that are required. We basically say a particular function call has certain capabilities of calling other functions, not other functions. And we define the capabilities. These are programmable. And the user defines these capabilities, and there are hardware data structures that ensure that capabilities are maintained across micro virtual machines. So this is the lightweight tagged microarchitecture. This is what we presented last year, and we have a working implementation of this as well in-house. Eon, these are reliability-enabled cores. So lockstep cores is something that we want to do. We've started the effort, and we expect something in mid-next year to have a lockstep core for the E-class, at least, out there. RISO is recompute. We had one implementation 2 years back on Shakti C-class, which we've published at ADS. And fault-tolerant fabrics is something we are working with. So C-class cores are the typical testbed for these. You want performance, because a lot of these fault-tolerant techniques are going to take a hit at hardware, right? So we want to reduce the hardware overheads. So we're going to have single error correction, double error detection mechanisms. And we've optimized these for the ISA itself. A certain amount of the RISC-V ISA has certain characteristics which can be leveraged to develop double error detection and actually give a correction for double errors as well, right? So I can discuss more in detail as to what our techniques for those are. RISO to error to detect and mitigate single error upsets due to radiation, environmental effects. We also have diagnosis mechanisms for adder subtractors. You don't need to go really TMR. You can tri-modular. You can actually go dual modular, and we have diagnosis mechanisms which can identify which of those has failed, and you can switch them off, save power, and use the one that's non-faulty. It comes with its own, pros and cons. We also are looking at redundant bus. Bus fabrics, when you go multi-core or you go multi-fabric or you have a hierarchy of fabrics, they become a huge concern. Taking care of those is not so easy. So we have certain techniques that we're looking at redundant buses. And lockstep multi-cores, this is the top level, the best that we would have to offer mid next year. Recomputation techniques, adder subtractors. So these are some of the published works that we did back in 2015, and we still are optimizing these for different ALU computes. And that's the general purpose architecture that's out there. And that's me. You can contact me for more information. Thank you. Questions?
So on C-class core, you have FPU, floating point unit?
Yeah. The C-class is the full-fledged RISC-V IMAFD compliant.
So when you said HPC, do you support transcendental functions, square root and inner square root? I know in RISC-V, only the division and square roots are supported. But other than that, transcendental functions are not supported. So
this is completely RISC-V compliant today.
Yeah.
We have not added floating point or special instructions on the base offering.
Uh-huh.
What we plan to do is use the base for different applications and then define those instructions for them. But if you're going to use just the C class,
Do you have performance metrics for HPC for FPU?
Performance metrics? No, I have the DMIPS. The DMIPS for the C class is 1.72. For the floating points, we have not run benchmarks on these, or they're not published yet. Yes.
Yeah, but can you just elaborate on that? How you are going to mitigate SEU?
So what we have, what we've done in one of the versions of our course is we've gone, instead of a tri-modular, we've gone dual modular. And whenever an event upset happens, which causes a bit.
But it will be in the same core.
Yes. These are optimizations for a single core. So a single core will have two ALUs or two combinational logics. And you do a check whether both of them are equal. If they're not, there is a diagnosis mechanism which helps you identify which of these two are faulty. You can switch that off and use the non-faulty or the clean core, clean combo logic.
But among these two, we cannot find out which one is faulty.
We can. We have the fault diagnosis logic. So for an adder, if you give them complement inputs, I can identify which of these two ALUs is faulty. I can switch them off and use the other one for all compute. So I have diagnosis mechanism as hardware, not software, which can identify these at runtime.
That is your known input with output you
yes,
know.
Yes, yes, that yes, you yes, here. Yes.
Okay.
On the C class variant.
I'm sorry. Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yeah.
So on the C class variant, you spoke about leveraging on the existing ISA to do the segdet, right?
Correct.
Error corrections. Can you speak a little bit more about that? What's exactly that?
Sorry, leveraging ISA?
So, to do the segdet, right? Single error correction.
Segdet, okay. So, we've done an analysis on the, so the segdet logics will sit typically at your combo logics each time on the pipe stage, right? So, let's say you have a five-stage pipeline, something like this, right? So, you fetch the instruction and kept it here, and you're going to have a segdet logic that sits here as well before you go on and latch it to the combo logic. So the instruction opcodes, there might be a double error detection, but there's only one valid opcode in the RISC-V ISA. So I can actually use those and fix the double error also. So this might not scale well for all ISAs or all future ISAs, but if we can re-encode or we can do those encodings, because the instruction set is small, it's 40 instructions, and even if I have a 5-bit opcode, that's 32 instructions or 32. I'm not using all of them, right? So there's an I opcode, there's an immediate opcode. So detecting errors and fixing them is much easier with you when you have a small subset of instructions. Yeah.
So I'm interested in your guaranteed computation model.
Yeah.
I have a multifaceted question.
Yeah.
One is I'm interested in the tools. From a tools perspective, so how does the user express what the time per computation should be? Second part of the question is, how do you guarantee it? Do you look at it from a core perspective, or do you look at it from a subsystem perspective, or from a whole SoC perspective? Because from a core perspective, that's not good enough.
So this is not from the core perspective. Okay, for your first question, we're looking at time execution through, so what we're using is TVMs. So TVM is an open stack which converts a CAFE or a TensorFlow platform model to low-level virtual machine commands. And what we are actually trying to do there is the intermediate representations of a neural network model, whether it's convolution or it's you have different combinations. Each of those are functions, and we define the time taken for those functions for a particular platform, right? So for us, it's the systolic array. And if I'm doing convolution on systolic, it's going to be X bound. And when you put up your network model on top of this framework, and you can run the execution, and we can give you a time guarantee saying that this is the expected time that systolic arrays on Shakti is going to be, or if you run this on NVIDIA CUDA applications, this is what it's going to look like. So we are hacking the TVM software stack to give you those time guarantees as soon as you put in your network model.
So it's a particular class of problems you're solving. So,
yes.
So you know, for example, a baseband solution where the computation and data flow needs to be guaranteed, you can't express that with this method. This is just for neural networks.
So the systolic, so the accelerator that we've talked about here is for AI and ML accelerators. So they are typically meant to do neural networks. But if you're able to represent the same model as a matrix computation, which is, so what TVM does is it breaks down your computation model to given instructions. So if you represent your baseband model in those given instructions, you can still leverage the same stack.
Only if it maps onto that model.
Yes.
There is basically a fundamental problem in capturing time in CPU architecture. And the problem arises because time is not a first-class object in your high-level definition languages also. One of the things we have asked the BlueSpec folks is to have something like time pragmas and stuff so that by design, I can predict upper and lower bounds for a set of logic. Because unless you go through computation, like a cache miss or something where it is unpredictable, in combination logic, for example, in a floating point, if it's early in and out, I can specify lower and upper bounds. So at least you will start having some formal knowledge of how many cycles a particular type of computation will take.
Yes, yeah, so from a computation perspective, yeah. It's fine. To do that. From a system-wide perspective, it's so easy to do.
It's not easy, but yeah.
If you've got, a base station, you want to transfer this amount of data from here, that includes computation and...
We are actually designing LTE 5G modems. Right, both, and we are facing the same problem. The problem also arises at the higher level where, because unless the algorithm is not bounded, I can't give you time guarantees anyway, right? I can predict that a particular mathematical operation is bounded within a certain time. System-wide guarantees are not really a function of the SoC per se, but even in the SoC, we could potentially give something saying, I could have arbitration, I could have priority, I can say that if it is this function, guaranteed you'll get a slot on the bus within so many cycles and all of that. I agree, it is not deterministic, but I can give you hooks to make it more predictable at the SoC level. But not enough thought has been given about this, right? We have kind of assumed that it's an unbounded problem. We are trying to see if we can make the problem tractable.